John's Gospel, chapter 19, verses 1 to 5. Then Pilate took Jesus and had him flogged, and the soldiers twisted thorn twigs into a crown and put it on his head, threw a purple robe around him, and kept coming into his presence, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews!" And then they slapped him with their open hands. Then Pilate went outside again and said to them, "Look, I bring him out before you here to show you that I find nothing criminal about him at all." And at this Jesus came outside too, wearing the thorn crown and the purple robe. "Look," said Pilate, "here's the man."
Like you. Oh, there is none like you. No one else can touch my heart like you do. And I could search for all eternity long and find there is none like you.
John's Gospel, chapter 3, verses 16 to 21. For God loved the world so much that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him shall not be lost, but should have eternal life. You must understand that God has not sent his Son into the world to pass sentence upon it, but to save it through him. Any man who believes in him is not judged at all. It is the one who will not believe who stands already condemned, because he will not believe in the character of God's only Son. This is the judgment, that light has entered the world, and men have preferred darkness to light because their deeds are evil. Anybody who does wrong hates the light and keeps away from it, for fear his deeds may be exposed. But anybody who is living by the truth will come to the light to make it plain that all he has been done through God. Amen.
Thank you.
Luke's Gospel, chapter 23, verses 32 to 43. Two criminals were also led out with him for execution, and when they came to the place called the Skull, they crucified him with the criminals, one on either side of him. But Jesus himself was saying, "Father, forgive them. They do not know what they are doing." Then they shared out his clothes by casting lots. The people stood and stared, while their rulers continued to scoff, saying, "He saved other people. Let's see him save himself, if he really is God's Christ, his chosen." The soldiers also mocked him by coming up and presenting sour wine to him, saying, "If you are the King of the Jews, why not save yourself?" For there was a placard over his head which read, "This is the King of the Jews." One of the criminals hanging there covered him with abuse and said, "Aren't you Christ? Why don't you save yourself and us?" But the other one checked him with the words, "Aren't you afraid of God even when you're getting the same punishment as he is? And it's fair enough for us, for we've only got what we deserve. But this man never did anything wrong in his life." Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And Jesus answered, "I tell you truly, this day you will be with me in paradise."
Thank you.
Matthew chapter 16, verses 21 to 26. From that time onwards, Jesus began to explain to his disciples that he would have to go to Jerusalem and endure much suffering from the elders, chief priests and scribes, and finally be killed and be raised to life again on the third day. Then Peter took him on one side and started to remonstrate with him over this. "God bless you, Master. Nothing like this must happen to you." Then Jesus turned round and said to Peter, "Out of my way, Satan. You stand right in my path, Peter, when you look at things from man's point of view and not from God's." Then Jesus said to his disciples, "If anyone wants to follow in my footsteps, he must give up all right to himself, take up his cross and follow me. For the man who wants to save his life will lose it, but the man who loses his life for my sake will find it. For what good is it for a man to gain the whole world at the price of his own soul? What could a man offer to buy back his soul once he had lost it?" Luke chapter 23, verses 44 to 49. It was now about midday, but darkness came over the whole countryside until 3 PM, for there was an eclipse of the sun. The veil in the temple sanctuary was split in two. Then Jesus gave a great cry and said, "Father, into your hands I commend my spirit." And with these words, he died. When the centurion saw what had happened, he exclaimed reverently, "That was indeed a good man." And the whole crowd who had collected for the spectacle, when they saw what had happened, went home in deep distress. And those who had known him, as well as the women who had followed him from Galilee, remained, standing at a distance, and saw all this happen.
Thank you.
I'd like to start today by reading some verses from Paul's letter to the church at Philippi. Now, these verses form part of a passage which, although we haven't actually shared this Easter, they underpin everything that we have shared during this week. And these verses will continue to be Tracy's focus on Sunday when we celebrate the resurrection of Jesus. So I'd like to read from Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 to 8. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Instead, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. And, being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Now, I wonder if you have ever been humiliated. Now, it wouldn't surprise you to know that on more than one occasion in my life, I've managed to humiliate myself. But there have also been occasions when I've been the victim of humiliation. I've been the innocent victim in humiliation. The word humiliation is a bit like the words love and hate. We've kind of diluted their meaning by using them in contexts which probably deserve a lesser word. For example, we say, I love chocolate or I hate coconut, when actually we don't love or hate either of those things. And it's the same with humiliation. I wonder what crosses your mind when you think of humiliation. You probably think of somebody, knocking a drink over in a restaurant or spilling food down their top when they're out with friends, or perhaps falling over in public. Now, if you ever find yourself in a tricky situation and you need somebody to come alongside you with sympathy and empathy, then I could think of nobody better to recommend than Tracy. She is a natural pastor. Unless the reason that you find yourself in a difficult position is because you've fallen over. I don't know what it is about falling over, but Tracy can never see anybody fall over. Doesn't matter what their age is or how much they appear to hurt themselves. Tracy can't see anybody falling over in public without the first reaction being to laugh. A couple of weeks ago, we were taking a walk down by the front. We were going past the Cliffs Pavilion, and there was a gentleman there about my age on his skateboard. And I discreetly and quietly said to Tracy, "What is it with men that don't know when it's time to hang up their skateboard?" And then this man, I don't know if he was trying to impress us, but he was attempting some death-defying stunt, and he ended up on his backside, and we both saw him fall, and it looked as if he'd really quite badly hurt himself. Well, I hope he couldn't see Tracy's reaction. He probably had other things on his mind at the time, but Tracy just collapsed into giggles. Now, I've mentioned in these meetings before that I have problems with my joints, and one of the ways that that has manifested itself in recent months is that I struggle sometimes to get in and out of the car. When this first happened, I ended up sitting on the pavement, and when Tracy saw that I'd fallen over, she began laughing, and I think she didn't stop laughing for another 24 hours. Now, when it happened the second time, she laughed a little bit less. And when it happened the third time, I think then she could see that actually I had an issue that required sympathy and support rather than something that should be laughed at. But when we think of humiliation, as I've said already, we probably think of somebody knocking something over, bumping into somebody, or falling over in public. And yet the word humiliate is a much, much stronger word than that. When somebody is humiliated, they are stripped of all their value. They're completely exposed before the world with no value or status whatsoever. Now, Christ on Good Friday was humiliated. I've always thought it's rather a strange thing that when we talk about somebody being humble, and we talk about somebody being humiliated, the two words, although they mean the same thing, actually create in our minds quite different images. If I said to you that this week I met somebody who was humble, then you would probably think that I was being complimentary and positive. Whereas if I told you that this week I met somebody who had been humiliated, that would paint a quite different picture in your mind. In the Bible reading we read earlier, it talks about Christ humbling himself. And perhaps because of that, there is maybe a tendency when we read those words to think of humble in a positive way, thinking it as an example of his character, his righteousness, which of course it was. But it was also much more than that. When Christ humbled himself, we're told that he humbled himself by being obedient unto death. And then it goes on to say, even death on a cross. Now, in a few moments, those of you who are brave enough, we're going to watch a video that I've created to the song The Reason. But the images are taken from the film The Passion of the Christ. Now, there is a very clear disclaimer before the video begins, and one of the benefits of worshipping in this way is that you have a pause button. If you really can't stomach the thought of watching this 3 or 4 minute video, then you can of course fast forward. But I really would encourage you to watch the video, because it gives us, as close as we can possibly get perhaps, an idea of what humiliation meant for Christ on Good Friday. One of the choruses that we often sing at this time of year is the chorus, Lord, make Calvary real to me. But of course, the truth is that that is a prayer, no matter how sincerely we might make it, that God just cannot answer completely. There is no way that we can come anywhere near understanding what Christ went through on Good Friday. Even if we could, by some stretch of the imagination, get some kind of idea of how much he suffered physically and emotionally, there is absolutely no way that we could have any idea of what he went through spiritually. Christ on the cross took upon himself the sins of the whole world. Every bad, every cruel, every sadistic act that had ever taken place and ever would take place, he voluntarily took upon his own soul. Now, I don't know about you, but sometimes I read a story in the newspaper or see a news item on the television which is particularly disturbing, and that bad taste can stay with me for some days to come. I remember in my early 20s, I read a book, a factual book about Charles Manson and his family, and I was disturbed for months after reading that book because of the images it had created in my mind. Yet Christ voluntarily took upon himself the feelings and emotions associated with the sins of the world. He took upon himself the consequences of all those acts. So there is no way, no way whatsoever that I can ever truly appreciate what he went through. But as I said, watching the video will have an impact upon you. And if you can, and I really would encourage you, if you can, to watch it. It's just a few minutes, but if you can watch it, it will bring home to you in an incredibly powerful way just some of what Christ went through on Good Friday. Now, Christ died on the cross for two reasons. Well, probably more than that, but two reasons that I want to talk about today. The first reason was the obvious one. He died that we might be forgiven. He died that we might go to heaven. He died to win our salvation and to determine our eternal destiny. But as we reminded ourselves in the Bible reading that we read just a few moments ago, he also died as an example to us as to how we should live. Have this mind in you, which was in Christ Jesus, your Lord, who being found In the nature of God, did not snatch at equality with God, but humbled himself, taking upon himself the form of a servant, being found in human form, and becoming obedient unto death, even death on a cross. So Christ also underwent what he underwent by way of teaching, to show us what we should expect if we decide to follow him. Now, earlier on in the Bible reading that we shared from Matthew 16 and in the duet that Bev and Keith brought to us, we were reminded again that if we want to follow Christ, there is a requirement that we must take up our cross and follow him. Now, we cannot possibly, no matter where we live or what the persecution is like where we live, we cannot, as we've already clearly said, we cannot experience what Christ experienced. But what we can do, what we must do, is recognize that following Christ is going to result in exposure to humiliation. Now, the last time I spoke with you, the 21st of March, I spoke about Minnie Lamb, and I spoke about the evangelism that the Salvationists carried out in the 1880s. And I said that perhaps our reluctance sometimes to share the gospel is this feeling that we sense that we have to share the gospel in the same way the Salvationists did in the 1880s. And I made the point that actually the gospel of 2021, that the evangelism of 2021 was the creation of a community where people could feel they belonged, where they could come alongside Christ and become recipients of his transforming power. Now, to redress the balance and to be completely fair to Minnie Lamb, once she settled in Westcliff and became a soldier at Southend Citadel, she began to engage in both forms of evangelism. She certainly was an evangelist with her mouth, and she took every opportunity to share the good news about Jesus in her speaking. But she also became an evangelist in that more contemporary fashion, whereby she began to create a community where people felt they could belong, where they could come alongside Christ and become recipients of his transforming power. I really would encourage you, even if you don't have a great interest in Salvation Army history, I would encourage you to get a copy of Keith's book. It's on Amazon, and the second of the two books, the one that talks about Minnie Lamb's life in Southend-on-Sea, is really quite an incredible read. She became a magistrate, she became a probation officer, she got heavily involved in work with the council and with other institutions in the town. And she did all of that not for personal glory or for personal gain, but she did it because within her was this overwhelming compulsion to be an advocate for those who had nobody else to stand up for them. You know, it must have been at times humiliating for Minnie Lamb. There must have been times when she had been surety for somebody who had been accused of a crime, and she said, "I'll look after them, but bind them over into my care and I will work alongside them," only for that person to badly let her down. And there must have been other Christians in the town who looked down their noses at her, wondering why she wanted to associate with people of such a low class and such a low moral character. But Minnie Lamb exemplified that type of Christianity, which I believe is exactly the type of Christianity that is required today. A Christianity where she sought to create a community where people with no friends could be befriended, and people who didn't understand what it was like to be loved could be loved. When I was thinking about the life of Minnie Lamb, and I was thinking about the humiliation that Christ suffered on Calvary, and thinking about what that means for us, I found myself being drawn to Will Brand's song that we often sing in our meetings. Now, usually when we sing these words, we apply them personally. We see them as a challenge to ourselves. But With all these thoughts going around in my mind and these words came into my mind, I began to think of them not necessarily only in relation to myself, but in relation to the church community at Southend that I, along with Tracy, am called to lead. It began with the likes of Minnie Lamb reaching out to the lost in a wonderful way, whereby they created a community that existed so that people could feel they belonged and that they were loved. But I'm afraid that somewhere along the way, I think we have got lost. I think somewhere we've lost our way and we've drifted from our first love. And we need to return to it. When I last spoke, I asked a very awkward question, not only of you, but also of myself. And I asked the question, when was the last time that we had had a conversation with somebody who didn't know Jesus that had resulted in them finding a relationship with the life giver? I want to ask an equally awkward question this week. I want to ask you, when was the last time you made friends with somebody in your community that everybody else despised and looked down upon? When was the last time you opened up your home to an individual within Southend that nobody else had time for? Such an action would run the risk of being humiliating. It would certainly challenge and break down any sense of pride that we might have within our hearts and minds. Let me read to you this song. When from sin's dark hold thy love had won me, and its wounds thy tender hands had healed, as thy blessed commands were laid upon me, growing light my growing need revealed. Thus I sought the path of consecration, when to thee, dear Lord, my vows were given, and the joy which came with full salvation winged my feet and filled my heart with heaven. But, there's always a but, isn't there? But my heart at times with care is crowded. Oft I serve with weak or laden hands, and that early joy grows dim and clouded as each day its heavy toll demands. Have I ceased from walking close beside thee? Have I grieved thee with an ill-kept vow? In my heart of hearts have I denied thee. Speak, dear Lord, O speak, and tell me now. Friends, our Christianity has to be seen in the way that we interact with those within our community who are friendless and loveless. Have you ever thought about what Christ's last act on earth was as a human being? We read about it earlier in one of the readings that we shared, but I wonder if you've ever thought about it before. The last thing Christ did on earth, in spite of the pain and suffering that he was undergoing, as he hung on the cross, the last thing he did before he breathed his last was to forgive a dying thief. That's our calling. That's our raison d'etre, to go into the world with the good news of the gospel. Good news that says Christ died. Christ came not to condemn the world, but to save it. What was it Jesus said to the disciples and the Pharisees when he was challenged about going to Zacchaeus' house for tea? Do you remember what he said? A doctor doesn't go to those that are well. He goes to the sick. The Son of Man didn't come to call the righteous, but to call the unrighteous. We're going to watch this video now. And if you, as I said, if you have the stomach to watch it, and it will make you wince, and I'm quite sure it will make you cry, I'm quite certain that you will find watching it an incredibly humbling experience. But as you watch it, and as you are reminded by the words of the song that we are the reason he suffered and died, I pray that we would all, in an act of humility, say to the Lord, Father, I renew my covenant with thee. Show me the people I need to love. Show me the people I need to befriend. Show me how to bring them into your family.
As little children, we would dream of Christmas morn, of all the gifts and toys we knew we'd find, but we never realized a baby born one blessed night gave us the greatest gift of our lives. We were the reason that he gave his life. We were the reason that he suffered and died. To a world that was lost, he gave all he could give to show us the reason to dark and cloudy day.
May God bless you and stay safe.